चेयरपर्सन मैम, मिसेस स्नेह सिंह मैम, ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट्स, फैकल्टी एसएफआई, प्रिंसिपल एसएफआई, एसजीएमसी एंड बीएड फैकल्टी, एंड वार्म वेलकम टू आवर स्पीकर्स ऑफ द डे, मिस विशाली गुप्ता एंड मिस प्रियंका भार्गवा. मिस विशाली गुप्ता इज ड्यू ग्रेजुएट एंड ट्रेन्ड एट हार्वर्ड ग्रेजुएट स्कूल ऑफ एजुकेशन यूएसए इन डीपर लर्निंग फॉर ऑल, स्टेम्स इंस्ट्रक्शंस एंड ग्लोबल एजुकेशन इन स्कूल्स. मिस विशाली गुप्ता इज एन ऑथर, एन एजुकेशनिस्ट एंड फाउंडर ऑफ वन टीचर वन साइंटिस्ट. Has 20 years of involvement with development of high quality education. She has written many books and published papers in various well-known journals. Welcome, ma'am, to our show.
Maintaining your computer sometimes requires you to boot up in safe mode to fix problems or save your work.
We have another speaker with us today of the day is Priyanka Bhargava, spiritual life coach, therapist, and psychic healer. And she is MBA as well. Priyanka ji is a certified past life regression therapist, hypnotherapist, certified angel healer, and core somatic integration therapist. Heading in various cities of India like Delhi, Mumbai, Lucknow, Bhopal, Rishikesh, etc. Specific modality is inner child healing. I extend my warm welcome both my esteemed speakers. Now I request Vishali ji to start with the session. Best wishes to all the speakers and to all the participants. Enjoy the today seminar and webinar. Thank you. I request Vishali ma'am to start with the session.
Ma'am, please unmute yourself. Vishali ma'am, please unmute yourself. Ma'am, you are on mute mode. Vishali ma'am.
Can you hear me
yes.
now?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for welcoming both me and Priyanka, ma'am, on this webinar.
Our pleasure, ma'am.
It's a special, very special feeling to be here on this platform and sharing something very peculiar to this time. I mean, social and emotional learning is something which is very, very important in today's time, especially with this coronavirus thing and the lockdown. It is a very peculiar time for this topic. And I think it is both academically as well as socially and emotionally that the child needs to be empowered. And so does the teacher and the parent, because there is a shift in the role that is happening now. And many parents and teachers are finding it difficult to handle these uncertain times, because suddenly they are thrown into a situation which is not normal. And everyone's lives are off gear. So before we really get into the academic aspect, I think it would be fair to understand the theory of mind from Priyanka ma'am, because that is where the journey of the child begins. And so I would request Priyanka ma'am to first start with the theory of the mind.
So good afternoon, everybody. And it's a pleasure to be a part of a platform where a lot of good work is done by teachers. And being a student myself all my life and being a teacher myself, I understand the importance and role of teacher. And this is something I want to share with you all today, that the role of the teacher is so very important in a child's life. Like we usually say ki ek bachcha jo hai wo ek matki ki tarah hota hai, you know, it's like a clay pot, and how we shape up the clay pot is all depending upon the teachers. Agar us matke ko shape dete hain uske parents, तो उस मटके को जो पकाना होता है मंदी, आज टीचर्स की रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी होती है. ऑल द मोर बिकॉज में लॉट ऑफ टाइम इज स्पेंड इन स्कूल बाय द चाइल्ड, लाइक 6 hours द चाइल्ड इज देयर इन द स्कूल, एंड ऑल्सो यूजली पेरेंट्स आर वर्किंग now, and in this scenario come the secondary care giver of a child. They usually it of it, or some of you must be aware of it. So like you were just viewing a slide there about the theory of mind, we have three kind of like minds ki layers hoti hai. One is the conscious mind, one is the subconscious mind, and the other is the unconscious mind. So जो कॉन्शियस माइंड होता है हमारा, उसके अंदर जो मेमोरीज होती हैं, दे आर बेसिकली शॉर्ट टर्म मेमोरीज, लाइक यू नो 5 to 6 hours की. लाइक हमने कल क्या खाया था, वो हमारी कॉन्शियस मेमोरी में नहीं रहता है, इट गोज टू आर सबकॉन्शियस मेमोरी. कैन वी हैव द स्लाइड प्लीज. So whatever is there in the subconscious mind is all the information, all the data that we are storing ever since we are born. So like in the subconscious mind, what happens is wherever there is like what did you eat, or what did you talk to somebody, ya fir aapne kal kya kiya tha, ya aapke saath mein koi pleasant experience hua, ya aapke saath mein koi traumatic experience hua, तो वो सारी मेमोरीज जो होती हैं आप स्टोर करते जाते हो आपकी सबकॉन्शियस माइंड में. शुड आई वेट फॉर द स्लाइड टू अपीयर ऑन द स्क्रीन?
आई थिंक द
शेयर स्क्रीन.
यस मैम, इट इज जंपिंग बैक. आई डोंट नो यू शेयर्ड व्हाट.
यस मैम, नाउ इट इज विजिबल.
इट इज.
यस मैम, यस मैम.
Okay,
great. So can you see here, there is conscious mind, there is a critical filter which is called the critical mind, and then the subconscious mind. Now subconscious mind is also called the modern memory, and it has like 88% of our memories are stored in the subconscious mind. There are both negative and positive memories.
Sorry,
which are stored.
Sorry to disturb
mind.
You ma'am, sorry to disturb you ma'am, there is one baby on the mic. He's making it very inaudible. Is there anyone whose mic is on? Please put down your mic.
Shaili ma'am, please unmute yourself now.
Okay, shall we continue?
Okay. So now, as Priyanka ma'am explained, it is very important that we make learning.
See, the thing is that when we talk about this part of the subconscious mind, so now whatever you are telling your student, whatever you are teaching your student, going in this subconscious mind. So one has to be very careful about the information that you are putting into the mind of the child. Like for example, if you're telling a child that, you know, you're not smart, you're lazy, you are dumb, or you're not able to understand anything. So it is all creating an impact in a child's mind. The memory is going to stay with the child forever, even if the child does not remember it consciously. But his behavior, his whole life can change with an injunction that has been given to the child. So that is why the role of a teacher becomes very important, because you're shaping up the whole personality of a child. And I think Vishali would be able to make you understand better that how important it is for a teacher to give the right kind of education to a child for the overall development of the child. Vishali?
Yeah. You know, it's very important that in today's times, we make the environment more effective again, so that learning is happening in a deeper and meaningful manner. Very important for children to build meaningful learning. Very important. Can you just mute all the other parts?
It's not over until the last one is born.
Can you hear me? Okay. So now it is very important to make learning effective and engaging. You know, if we look at the curricular expectations, the curricular expectations require that the learning environment is relevant and authentic also. You know, many times when we see children coming to classrooms, then studying is perceived as a burden. Because what happens usually that the teacher is teaching with the board over there, the chalk and board method becomes passive teaching. With the result, the child is not understanding fully. So the learning is not going into the deeper layers of the mind. As Priyanka ma'am explained about the theory of the mind, what is happening that it just stays in the volatile memory. And the moment the child goes out of the classroom, it is gone because it has not integrated into the deeper layers of the mind. Therefore, it is very important that however the methodology that we use in the classrooms is more engaging, more relevant and authentic. You know, kitni baar bachcha sochta hai, arey mujhe ye padhne se fayda kya hai? Because that relevance of what he's studying is not established in the classrooms. And today in this coronavirus times when there is lockdown, the child is in his environment all the time. And it therefore becomes very important that teachers help parents use the environment, the home environment, as a learning lab. And it is all possible. And if you see, sadly, all the teachers are right now sitting in front of the computer using Zoom and are trying to teach the child. And you know, again, it is not active teaching that is happening. It is passive teaching that is happening at this point. Because again, it is like the chalk and board method. However, if we allow children to engage with their environment, learn from their environment, that learning is going to be deeper. How many of you have heard of the draft national education policy that got released last year? Have you all heard about the national education policy? Okay, so there was a draft national education policy that was released last year. And this year, they're going to be releasing the final national education policy sometime, I think, in December. And if you look at the crucial points of the education policy, they are advocating experiential learning. And you know, that in itself, I mean, this lockdown period can be a perfect time to lay the groundwork for experiential learning. Kitchens can be perfect science labs. Bathrooms can be perfect physics labs. They can teach them mathematics concepts. If they sit in the balcony, they can be perfect bio labs. If they observe, if they are made to observe concepts. Parents talking to children. I mean, nowadays they are there at home. And if they are talking effectively at home, their communication skills can get done. You know, you're laying the foundation for language skills. And what is happening right now, again, we are looking at technology. Children are looking bored. They are just sitting in front of Zoom and teachers are trying to put across the curriculum. Is this the right way to go forward? I mean, that's a question that I want everyone to think while we are going through the webinar. Then when we talk of the draft national education policy, there are values and life skills. Now, values and life skills is something that can easily get integrated while the child is at home. Because when he is interacting with people at home, automatically life skills are getting integrated. You don't have to sit with a textbook to teach that. It is happening automatically. Has everybody heard of the learning outcomes? Has everybody heard of learning outcomes? Okay, now learning outcomes is something that NCERT has laid out. And now, based on the learning outcomes, the teaching methodologies and the pedagogies are going to be evaluated. And learning outcomes are just emphasizing on an engaging and relevant environment. How to make teaching more engaging, more relevant. If we look at the curricular expectations of the learning outcomes, the first one says, acquire awareness about immediate wider surroundings through lived experiences on various themes related to daily life. Now, if you look at it, this is the perfect time to achieve these learning outcomes at home, because the child is living his life 24/7 right now. And all these learning outcomes can slowly, the foundation for all these learning outcomes can get laid at home. Nurture natural curiosity and creativity for the immediate surroundings. Develop sensitivity for the natural, physical, and human resources in the immediate surroundings. Point out, raise issues related to equality, justice, and respect for human dignity and rights. Now, if we look at these four key areas around which learning outcomes are created all across the various classes, you will see that this time is the best time that parents can be guided how to address them at home, how to lay the basic foundation so that when they go back to school, it becomes easier for teachers. So, you know, I mean, all these curricular expectations can actually be strengthened during this lockdown. And if you look at it, the NEP says PISA. Has everybody heard of PISA? PISA is basically a program for international students' assessment. And from this year onwards, NCERT is trying to make PISA assessments compulsory from grade 10 onwards. And you know, PISA is nothing else but skill-based assessment. And children can actually do very well in PISA studies if they are skilled. And what is happening is that in our education system today, we are only gearing up children to get better marks in their exams. And what happens, that is promoting rote learning. And when the child is just carrying on memorizing concepts and facts, then the skills are not getting laid. What are the key skills? Can anybody tell me what are the key skills of the 21st century? There are four key skills that are needed in the 21st century, which are collaboration, critical thinking, creating, and communication. So, you know, critical thinking to take place, home environment is a perfect center, because here, when the child is applying concepts in his everyday life, he's making it contextual, real world, and he's applying and analyzing situations. You know, think about a child going to a kitchen and making a lemonade or making a sandwich, right? So the child, right from the beginning, if the parent is talking, if the teacher is guiding the parent how to communicate the concepts to the child will learn better. He will start relating concepts in his everyday life. Think about jab hum chawal dhote hain, right? Small little thing like every household would be having chawal dho rahe hain. Jab chawal dho rahe hain, so when the rice settles down, that is sedimentation. When water is thrown out, that is decantation. Right? So simple concepts like this, jab hum chai banate hain, channi se chhante hain, that is filtration. So basic concepts like this can actually help children be more engaged at home. They will find their learning more meaningful and contextual. And it will also develop sensitivity. Small observation skills, which they are not able to do in classrooms, can be done now. So, you know, these troubleshooting during COVID and uncertain times like this can actually mean that we make children more engaging at home. Instead of having Zoom classrooms, instead of, you know, I can see teachers sitting, I mean, maybe those are the expectations of the parents at the moment, but I see teachers sitting in front of the computer and pure pure chapters padhaye ja rahe hain aise. And what is happening? The child is just in front of the screen all the time. The child is looking at the screen. There is no human interface. Parents are also sometimes just giving them the gadget and moving away. So, bachcha kya daba raha hai, kahan ja raha hai, kuch nahi pata. knowledge is good, but then that has to be used effectively and efficiently. Unstructured environment of the home can actually also be used for increasing imagination in the child. You know how when you just give them a suitcase, suppose it's a small child, you just ask them, "Acha, drawer kholo, and now sort out things in the drawer." Right? The child is going to then, it depends on how the teacher structures the lesson plan and gives it to the parent. If the parent just gives a drawer and says, "Iske andar jitna saman hai, usko sort karo." Now the child can be asked to sort in terms of color, in terms of shape, in terms of materials used, in terms of the object, in terms of utility. There can be various ways. Then the child can be asked to make comparisons between the groups. So see how critical thinking will then come in. The child is engaged. So it depends on the various levels of classrooms that the child is at. Middle school children can be asked to create, to do problem solving over there at home. Choti si cheez, acha ye kooda pada hai. Now devise a method by which we can reuse things that are being thrown in the trash. So there, the innovation skills of the child get done. So the child starts thinking of innovative ways. How am I going to use, I can use some of these which are biodegradable. Now the child is sorting between biodegradable and non-biodegradable stuff. Ask them to design maybe a trash can which can help in composting. So, you know, it depends on how the teacher empowers the parent to use this time to make teaching and learning more engaging, because that is what is going to stay with the child. And while they are talking, and if the child is engaged at home, automatically the fear and panic goes because the child is enjoying his time at home. So social and emotional learning is happening automatically. He's becoming a sharper person. Because we have to understand that the teacher's role over here is to mentor the parents so that the screen time is less and the parents are getting empowered, because the parents have to now take over the role as teachers, and they may not have a background of teaching. They may lack those teaching abilities, and parents may also lack time. So what you can do is you can just give them lesson plans at this time. During the day, they can help them make a routine. Help them, because routine helps the child to really improve his social and emotional learning. Because a child knows time management then. See, these are all life skills. Once the child's routine is set, life skills, time management gets settled. So there are various ways in which we can empower parents at this point to take over the role of a teacher at home. Because at this time, the children are not coming to school, and then the social element is missing because they are not meeting their friends. So you can probably help parents how to make small groups of children, monitor them, and allow these activities to take place as a group. So then again, collaboration skills will come in, but that has to be monitored by the parent. So these are the ways in which parents can get involved. But teacher's role is now as a mentor for the parents at this time. Is too much technology the right way forward? This is one question that I want everyone to think about. Because suddenly if you see all over the internet, it's all about technology, technology, technology. But if the child is dealing with too much technology, there could be many, many things that the child is getting exposed to which he does not need to. See the locker room thing that happened. It's so sad that has happened. There are so many ways that the child can get exposed to abuse, to harm on the internet. Are they even ready for it? So there are various other ways in which it is impacting these children and which will be a long-term impact. One is the health of the child. Look at the way children are sitting in front of the computers, the effects that it will have on the child's physical being, the child's emotional being. the child's mental aspect and also the eyes. Look what a strain it is on the child to be in front of the screen all the time. And if you look at these pictures, the child is actually using the screen as a pseudo teacher. With the result, again, it is passive teaching that is happening. There is no active teaching. A for apple, B for ball, usme bhi chal raha hai. If it is storytelling, why can't the parent take over the role of a storyteller? Hum sab dadi nani se sunte aaye kahaniyan. Hum sab apni dadi naniyon se kahaniyan sunkar bade hue. So many things we learned from our from people at home, from our family members. So this is a very important time that children can bond with their family members and learn. As we always say that home is the first school of the child. So this can actually be the time when out of unconditional love, they will feel that unconditional family love and bond with each other. And that is when learning will become so meaningful and so joyous for a child. If you look at this, when we put them in front of technology, learning is happening in isolation. Bachcha ek bachcha ek phone pe laga hua hai, ek bachcha iPad pe laga hai. How are they going to understand human relations? You know, in times to come, artificial intelligence and machine learning will take over all these jobs of engineers, of doctors, of lawyers. But one thing that artificial intelligence cannot take over is the human experience that we have. It is the creativity that human beings have. It is the emotions that human beings feel. So these are the things that can be nurtured at this time. These are the things that we can bring in into the child's learning.
So you have to write them.
Ma'am, can we just mute this?
Nearby. Every time they come, you come, which is basically.
Screen time or family time? What do you think is a better learning opportunity? A family time can actually be great fun. You know, children can be asked to do outdoor and indoor observation activities. Activities and projects for experiential learning can be given to children. Learning through playway method can be introduced. You know, these are the dynamic approaches that are being introduced world over. And hum lack kar rahe hain abhi apne school structure mein. And that is because we are always running after completing the syllabus. But in primary classes, in elementary school, if we allow children to explore, if we allow children to do experiential learning, they will actually learn concepts very well. And they will, as Priyanka ma'am showed the theory of mind, it will go into the lower layers, into the deeper layers of the child's mind and will remain forever. So this is a very, very important time where we can start introducing them to these methodologies. Have you all heard of the theory of multiple intelligence? Well, this is a theory that was introduced by Howard Gardner. And Howard Gardner says that there are 8 intelligences that children possess. And according to the spectrum, the different qualities that the child has, these are present in different proportions in a child. So when we are engaging them at home, when we are giving them different opportunities to experience the world around them, the child can actually develop in all these 8 skills. You know, if you allow children to play, the body kinesthetic skills get done. If you allow children, when we are talking to children all the time at home, when parents and grandparents are talking to children, when children are talking to each other, the interpersonal skills are getting done. When you're reading stories to the child, the verbal and linguistic skills are getting done. When children are actually sitting and, you know, you can, a simple activity like asking children to guess what is the right size of the bowl that you should use to serve anything on the table. Suppose dal banai hai. Achha, choose karo kaun sa bowl, kaun sa bartan nikalein jisme hum isko serve kar sakte hain. So the estimation of the quantities, estimation of measures gets done there. So that is the logical and mathematical skills in various different ways that you can introduce. You can ask them, okay, today, for an older child, you can say, okay, now look at the graph of all the COVID cases across the world. Now, predict what can happen when. So, you know, prediction skills can get done. Ask them to research on the internet, take out the entire graphical curve of how coronavirus has affected each country, and then predict when we can expect it in India, when we can expect which stage in India. So logical and mathematical skills can get done. You can ask children to sit outside in the balcony, sit for 10 minutes, close your eyes, just be with yourself, and then observe the different kinds of sounds that you can hear outside. Make a list. See how the child will start connecting within also, and then he becomes a naturalist. He starts understanding the different sounds. He makes, how many children are sitting today and observing these concepts? How many children today have the time in classroom studies to sit under a tree and observe a nest? They don't. How many children sit and watch a butterfly suck nectar? They don't. And that's when learning becomes difficult for them, because it has not, they haven't seen it, they haven't observed it. So this is the time to help them connect with the world around them, connect with nature, so that they can actually learn those concepts. When they have observed these concepts here, then when you start teaching in the classroom, when the schools open up, they will start making connections. If the child has been sitting at home and feeling different kinds of leaves, hearing different kinds of sounds, looking at different kinds of pictures, you know, sitting with albums can be such a perfect way of teaching them right now. You can ask parents and grandparents to sit with family albums and help them connect with people. Then ask them to build perspectives around those pictures. These are things that we cannot do when the schools are open. This is the time to do these things. Then visual and spatial, again, if you are asking children to draw, you know, drawing can be a perfect way of connecting within also. And drawing can be a perfect way of making your perceptions visual. Like you can ask children, some children learn very well through visual arts. So you can ask children to draw paintings. You can ask children to draw posters and charts to express various feelings. That can also help children in learning. So learning is not just about question answers, fill in the blanks, and doing the textbooks. This is how we will also be able to meet our curricular expectations. And all that leads to experiential learning. Parents can be asked to spend some quality time. While he is painting, and the parent is making the child ask, what is he drawing? He is making the child, he or she is making the child construct meaning to that painting. And that will help in critical skills. Playtime. You know, when children are playing indoor games with their parents and grandparents, there is learning that will take place. Family bonds will happen. Then there are so many concepts that are hidden here. If you look at this carom board, you can ask children to sort according to colors, according to shapes, according to sizes, and then angles can get done. Then a child, when he's striking, the fine motor skills can get done. Eye and hand coordination can get done. Then you can also teach them about friction here. How we keep adding powder dal ke, aur hum carom khelte hain. Kyun? Taki wo smoothly jaye. सो हमने बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट फ्रिक्शन का यही डाल दिया बच्चे में. तब जब क्लासरूम में पढ़ाना होगा तब द चाइल्ड विल बी एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड इट बेटर. एंड दिस इज वॉट इज क्रिटिकल थिंकिंग स्किल. मेड चिल्ड्रन हेल्प इन हाउस होल्ड चोर्स. अ स्मॉल लिटिल थिंग लाइक दिस. अगर हम बच्चे को कहते हैं चलो आज हम सब मिलकर घर में सफाई करेंगे, यू डू दिस, तुम चलो बाहर की सफाई करो, राइट, और क्लीन अप अ चेयर आउटसाइड, द चाइल्ड इज गोइंग टू फिल अप दैट बकेट विथ वॉटर. वो फर्स्ट स्टेप इज उस बच्चे को ये समझ आ रहा है कि पानी, वॉटर हैज नो शेप, द बकेट हैज अ शेप. उस बच्चे को ये समझ आ रहा है कि इसको साफ करना जरूरी है. Cleanliness skills are getting done. Why is it important to clean it? That is getting done. Then health and sanitation यहीं पर ही पढ़ा सकते हो. And उसके बाद that child is also learning to help at home. So values and life skills are getting integrated. Kitchens are perfect labs. If a child is made to help in household chores, there is so much learning. Sara curricular learning can happen over there, depending on which class you are teaching. You know, a small bread making activity can be such a brilliant activity for grade 8. Hum microorganisms padhate hain. But bacche ko nahi samajh aata ki wo yeast, how is yeast helping the bread to expand in size? How are the pores getting done? English can be done. Ask children to write their experiences. Let them make a journal every day. Let them write their experiences every day. And that's how we can integrate math, science, English, and social studies to ho hi rahi hai when the child is interacting with the family. So family as a structure is getting done. When the child is extending it to the world by looking at the corona cases world over, how it is impacting everybody's lives. Social sciences are getting done. Economics can get done when you tell the child, okay, how has this lockdown affected the economy of the country? And then how will it impact the economy of the world? So economics is getting done. And what are the various ways in which, I mean, give them roles like MUN. Give them a role. Suppose you were the head of the country. What do you think you would do in such a situation? How would you have handled this situation if you were the prime minister? That is how we can build perspectives for children. So, you know, instead of making children sit in front of the screens and making them do passive learning, teachers can guide parents on how 2 hours of such learning can actually be so meaningful. Jab is bacche ne ye sab kuch ghar pe kara, then when the child comes to school, your teaching happened very fast because he would have experienced all this. So depending on whichever class you're teaching, you can actually make lesson plans. You can actually advise parents on how to make children observe and experience concepts at home, which you are otherwise not able to do it in the classrooms. So, you know, this is how we can effectively use these lockdown periods for curricular learning. Priyanka ma'am will now tell you how such a thing can actually help in the social and emotional development of the child in terms of how the child will actually find this more meaningful and deeper learning can take place and will be a happier child. Priyanka ma'am.
Yeah, hi. Vishali, it was really informative. So, Vishali ma'am has been, my video is off and I can't switch it on. I think host will have to switch it on.
Pooja ma'am.
Okay, never mind. So, when we talk about the current scenario where things are very uncertain, there is like a fear factor all around, I would to refer once again to the theory of mind that we were talking about. So there are 3 things that happen when there is an uncertain situation or when there is a panic or a trauma. So one thing that happens is a flight mode. The other thing that happens is flight. And the other thing is when you want to fight. So right now what is happening is that because of the news and news channels and all the WhatsApp messages and all the situations of this lockdown around, basically the problem is that the child is now getting very, people are hoarding things because they don't know when the shops are going to get open and the stuff like that. Okay. So now what is happening to child is that instead of taking the whole situation and facing it as a fighter or as a warrior, the child is somewhere getting very fearful about it. And as a teacher, and it's your responsibility to, I think, educate the parents that how can they help the child to shift from being fearful to be a warrior there or to be a fighter there. Because what will happen, you have no ideas that when this lockdown phase is over, the child would actually be fearful of death, or the child will not allow the parent to step out of the house because there is so much fear, no idea how a child is going to behave. Maybe, you know, like things that we have been hoarding at home, the groceries, the supplies and everything. So we have no idea that how a child is going to take it in terms of hoarding things when he becomes an adult. So now this is the right time where as a teacher, our responsibility is to tell the child that this situation is serious, but it is going to get over. And as a fighter or as a warrior, you have to follow these steps and then you will be safe. Secondly, what can be done is like when you're taking your lesson plan, and like, you know, you're doing all, I'm like, it's all the online sessions and the classes that are going on, they could possibly talk about not the harmful effects of lockdown, but about the positive effects of lockdown. Now you must be wondering, what are the positive effects of lockdown? Lockdown ne humko kya acha de diya hai? So there's very interesting thing that when I was interacting with a 7-year-old, my niece, she said the best thing about the lockdown is that I get to see my family more. I'm having my meals together with my family. So this is one positive thing that she just took up the whole scenario. And so, you know, there could be a lot of different things that the child is getting out of this lockdown. Like, you know, when now both the parents are at home, the cooking is happening, or the household chores are being managed. So now the child is seeing the father and mother both contributing in it. If they are living in a joint family, then their old uncle or aunts are also contributing to quality to a child. And this is what a dad would do, are getting broken now. So as a teacher, you know, you can probably take a class on how it is important for all the family members to come together and share the responsibility. So here, the child in this COVID situation of the lockdown is also getting to learn teamwork. They are also getting to learn the benefits of having a bigger family. Or they are learning the importance of having their parents or their grandparents around. They're also learning how to help their people, help their family. So there is a lot that is being learned indirectly or, you know, or passively by a child right now, but it is not getting highlighted, because what is being highlighted right now is the fear about the COVID. The child now is getting, yes. So yes, basically like somebody was saying that about the health, yes, now kids are getting more aware of the health. Because now they know what is the importance of washing hands and hygiene and things like that. They know that, you know, they play a very important role in the household, because every member and their effort is important. Like from, you know, you can ask, you have helped your parents in laying the table today, ya kisi ne aaj iron ke kapde utha ke rakhe kya, ya kisi ne aaj mummy ki help kari kya kapde sukhane mein. So you know, there are a lot of things that can be taught to a student which are positive about COVID. Because what memory base we are making right now is really going to play a very substantial role in future of the child, right? When we talk of things like, you know, playing games with kids, like as Vishali ma'am was saying, that carom could be a very good example of learning friction or angles. Excuse me. So there are other games which could be very good examples for a child to learn the important lessons about life, like a simple game of Ludo. So when you play Ludo, वो चार गोटियां होती हैं जिनको हम चलते हैं और हम दाने फेंकते हैं, डाइस फेंकते हैं. So very important thing or a very simple thing would be told to a child that जो आप डाइस फेंक रहे हो, that is what your good karmas are, and the move that you are making are according to the good things that you have done in your life. You, when a paw is moving forward, goti jab aage chalti hai, so it could be a very good example to tell a child that we need to move ahead in life. There is no looking back. One needs to stay in present and look for the future. Jab tak aap, jab goti move kar rahi hoti hai pure ghar mein, and then it goes back to its home, it could be taught in a way that once you start something, then you have to finish it. And no matter how much difficult it gets for you, you have to reach the goal, right? Another example could be of chess. Like on a chess board, there are different kinds of different kind of people in our lives. It could be a health worker or a doctor or an engineer. They can all be represented on the chessboard, that everybody has their own role to play. And when everybody sticks to their discipline, then together as a team, a game of chess can be won. And likewise, the game of life can be handled well if everybody is playing their role appropriately with discipline, like on a board of chess, right? So, and the second most challenging thing that is happening right now is that children are not able to meet each other. This is like a lot of isolated learning is happening. So, what is happening is that kids are not allowed to go and play outside. Bachcho ka interaction hota tha ek dusre se, wo nahi ho raha hai. There are only lesson plans which have been taken like 40 or 30 minutes in a class where 1 hour of class is there and there's only some recreational activity happening. Like all the students in that class are dancing or singing or playing a game together. So that could be a very good way where these kids can actually interact with each other and have some fun with each other, and also they can gel and like interact with each other. So other important thing that can be done is you can give them group activities. Like you can give them, please mute yourself. So you can okay, thank you. So what you can do is you can give them group activities like, you know, you can make a pair of two kids and you can ask them to do something together where they can have a conversation phone or they can have a chat on WhatsApp, and like according to the age of the child, the activities can vary. Probably, you know, they have to make a music video or a dance video or something where they can have more time to interact with each other. So these are the few things that could be done in this time, especially where we can tell a child that this situation is nothing to be fearful of. There's a lot that could be learned. You can give, you know, a child an essay to write about the effect of COVID or the positive effects of COVID. What have you gained in the last 60 days of lockdown? How important was it for you to, how good it was to have a good time with your family? What more have you learned from your family? Like, you know, stories, as Vishali was mentioning, you know, storytelling is a very important part. where parents can have some time with the kid before they sleep. They can share stories with them, teach them, you know, give them important life lessons or moral values through the stories. So this all could be dealt with in a very positive manner. And I think it's very important because the kind of memories which we are making right now are going to affect the future of our kid. So we have to create a very good memory bank here where the child learns to be a fighter, not be fearful or you know, not to run away from a situation. So I think that is very important. Yes. Vishali, would you like to add something?
Yeah, and I think, you know, when we talk of dynamic approaches towards teaching in today's times, we always talk of reflections. And if we look at it, our Indian curriculum system, our Indian curricular system does not give a scope of reflections. You know, reflective thinking is where we are not doing it in our classrooms. And during this time, during this lockdown, if you ask the child, if you tell parents to, you know, maybe start the diary writing, you know, this is the time when children are sitting at home. And if children can start writing diaries every day, what are they doing? How did the day unfold for them? They are connecting with their emotions as well. And the pressure of syllabus right now is not there. And children will then start reflective thinking. And you know, in dynamic methodologies like STEM education, STEAM education, reflective thinking is very, very important. And our children are lacking because in our everyday teaching curriculum, this is not a part of our curricular outcomes. And it is very, very important to inculcate that. And suddenly when we ask children to start thinking and become innovators in grades 9, 10th, 11, 12th, they are not able to do that because they've not been, you know, trained to do that. They've not been trained to connect with what went wrong, what was right that I did, how can I improve? You know, that scope of improvement is so important. And when children go to engineering colleges, and they have to create prototypes. The thing that biggest problem that you know, engineering colleges face is that children are not able to reflect on what they've done and how can they improve. So you know, that can be done during this time. That skill can be developed during this time. All that we as teachers need to do is guide our parents effectively because they are not teachers. And you know, they may not know these methodologies. It is for us to help instead of sitting in front of Zoom and taking these Zoom classes. If teachers could actually help parents on Zoom, that okay, today you could do this, this, this with your children. And then maybe, you know, basically the two, the parents and the teachers have to be like the two wheels of a cycle at the moment. I feel that is the role that teachers need to play at this time, rather than again, you know, doing passive teaching. We are, as it is, doing sage on the stage kind of a teaching in classrooms. This is a very unique time we've got. We may not get this time, and I hope we don't get this time, but what I mean is that we can actually use this time effectively for building things, for building skills that we are unable to do in our everyday classrooms. You know, with 40, 60 children, doing this in the classroom becomes very difficult. Experiential learning can become difficult in classrooms. But when you've got this time where children are at home, sara material ghar pe hai, you know, jo bachcha padhta hai, jitna hamara curriculum hai, jo hamare learning outcomes hai, uske liye jo jo required hai, wo ghar pe hai. It is just that this is the time where teachers need to bring that creativity from them, from within. How am I going to use this more effectively? Aisi teaching to hum roz kar hi rahe hain, but this is a unique time that we've got. So why don't we utilize this uniquely? You know, this is what I would like to say, that, you know, we teachers need to be more creative about it. And I think parents are more than willing to do these things at the moment. I think they would enjoy the process also, because it will bring the child and the parent very close to each other. Otherwise, they're all living isolated lives right now. And ye impact hame dikh bhi raha hai, you know, how parents and children are living isolated lives, and that is why there has been a decline in the values and life skills also in children, because that is the social structure that is missing. So I think a lot of thinking needs to be done by us on how we are
setting dekh unit beta,
on how we can use this time more effectively and meaningfully.
Jana padega kahin iska matlab.
So anyone who has any questions, anything that you want to know and understand?
Yes, ma'am. I can see number of questions in the chat box, so I will share with you some questions. So very first question which a participant is asking is, how to take care of these four skills which you told about in the 21st century in classes with 40 plus students?
Oh, it's very simple. All you need to do is divide children into groups. That is the primary thing. You know, divide children into groups of five. Five is the best thing. That's the number which scientists have seen. You know, child development scientists like Vygotsky and Piaget have all seen that groups of five is what you divide them into. And usually what happens, we divide them, ek bahut sharp bachcha ho, ek average bachcha, nothing like that. Please do not group them like that. Just divide them into groups of five, especially children who are not friends with each other. That way they start bonding with each other. Make one child a group leader, right? So these are classroom management skills. Divide children into groups of five. Automatically you've got eight groups. And if you make one child a group leader in every group, so there is leadership skill that is happening. And your groups are managed as micro groups. And you can tell them whichever group is not going to perform is not going to do the activity next time. So what will happen in a micro group, if there are five children in a group, even if two don't want to do, the other three are going to say, nee, hame karna hai. I want to do this next time. So your groups are also getting managed. And what you can do is you can keep changing that group leader every time for every activity. So every child gets to become a group leader. So gets leadership skills. So you know, this is in a group of 40, 50, 60, just divide them into groups and give them as a group task. So then again, when they're doing it as a group task, collaboration is happening. If you look at the four critical skills of 21st century, collaboration will happen. Because they will keep talking to each other, communication will happen. Because they have one task to complete, critical thinking is getting involved in it. And creativity will come out depending on the task that you have given. Right? So
very informative answer, ma'am. Yes. Next, there are some other questions as well. One participant is asking, how can we measure and develop the retention of a child?
See, retention kyun nahi hota? Retention tab nahi hota jab bachche ko samajh nahi aata. Or yeah, hum rote learning expect karte hain. If a child has done something, aaj agar bachcha roti bana raha hai, yeah, let's say if a child has felt a tomato, tomato ko usne pakda haath mein, right? And while he's holding a tomato in his hand, you are saying this is a three-dimensional figure. Ek bangle de do, ek chudi de do, aur ek tomato de do. What is the difference between the two? Right? A bangle is a two-dimensional figure. A tomato is a three-dimensional figure. क्या वो बच्चा कभी भूलेगा कि वो थ्री डायमेंशनल फिगर्स क्या होते हैं? कभी नहीं भूलेगा. So retention does not take place when we are trying to teach them with a chalk on the board. Retention happens when children are experiencing their learning, when children are taking charge of the learning. So retention is not a problem in that situation, when they have understood. when they are, that is why they say when they do things, when they observe things, then they always remember. Any other question? What do you have to say? I think Priyanka ma'am could also add to this retention thing in terms of the theory of mind, ma'am.
See, I think retention happens when a child is interested in a particular topic. So it is, like you said, when you give the child, you know, a practical example of it, or you help them learn it in a fun way, then the grasping increases and the retention also increases. So it's important to understand that not every child will do everything. So there's no point forcing a child to do certain things which he might not be interested in doing. So every child has its own different skill set.
Yeah.
So it is also important to understand what skill set does the child has and how much do we expect a child to understand. I do understand that there is a bare minimum amount of education which is required by every child, which is what our education system is. But then not every child will learn maths as good as the other child is learning. Some may have an aptitude for science, or some may have an aptitude for English or maths or other subjects. But yes, if you make it simple, make them understand the concepts. And one thing that you should never tell a child is that you are not able to understand it. Yeah, you know, you are a fool who is not able to understand it. Once you tag a child that he is foolish, then he'll stay foolish all his life for that particular subject.
Yeah, I think that is very
encouragement is important. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
To a weak child or a child who's struggling is very, very important, and that's where the teacher's sensitivity towards the child's emotions come out.
True.
Yeah. Any other question, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. There is one more question. How to change the mindset of those students who are not ready to learn?
I think
and are very much poor.
Sorry.
Yeah.
So mindset, I think, is something that we teachers, if we change our mindset, the child's mindset will also change. We get stuck.
And
I think Priyanka ma'am is a better person to answer this in terms of how mindset plays a role.
I'll attempt it, Vaishali. See, the thing is that mindset of a child depends on a lot of factors. How is the family at home? How are parents behaving? Is the family fully functional or not? Are there any kind of like disturbances in his upbringing? What is the relationship between the parents? How is being treated at home? How is the child is being treated at school? So the mindset will only change for a child if a teacher actually takes a personal interest in the child. You know, if the teacher tries and finds out ki ye bachcha aise behave kar raha hai, agar iska learning process slow hai, ya uska mindset aisa hai ki wo naughty hai, ya you know, he is aggressive, to uske piche family reason kya hai, background kya hai. Because most of the cases, for example, where a child is aggressive in school, either of the parent back home is aggressive. Right? If a child is depressed in the class, possibly one of the parent is depressed at home. Or there is a lot of performance pressure on the child. So you need to actually go in depth and study about the child and his psychology to understand the mindset.
There is one more question, ma'am. Should I put the question?
Yes, please.
Yes.
So one more question is there, that what activities we can take as counselors in these virtual classroom sessions?
I think as counselors, there are lots of, you mean to say the how they can improve their skills as counselors?
Yes. What activities the counselors can use in these virtual classroom sessions and all? So,
the academic counselor or the emotional counselor?
They haven't mentioned that. Whichever you would like.
Depends on what kind of counselor.
Emotional. They are asking for emotional.
Okay. So, see, for the emotional counseling part, I would request you all to please mute your audios. I'm not able to even hear myself. How will you hear me? Okay. See, when it comes to counseling, the best thing right now can be that you can give some artwork therapy to, artwork things to the kids. Maybe ask them to, for example, draw a situation of COVID in your society. How does your playground looks like right now? Art therapy is the best thing to do with children right now because it will help you understand the deeper layers of a child's thought process as of now. Because when you draw, you automatically go into a trance. And in that trance, your subconscious memory or mind reveals a lot about the current state of mind. So art therapy is one thing that you can do. You can have another activity where you can ask the child to do a role play. Like, you know, maybe of a mother or father or, you know, you can ask them to maybe demonstrate something. Like some of them can play a role of a virus and some of them can play a role of a doctor. And you can actually understand what a child thinks about that particular person or an individual as of now.
Yeah, and I would like to add there, you can also kind of give children, you know, jaise aata gunte, gunda hua aata de do. If the child is using that aata, and expressing, like, okay, now express yourself. Kuch bhi banao, jo man mein aa raha hai, jo emotion hai, usko express karo on this. Jo bhi feel kar rahe ho. If you're feeling happy, okay, show how will you feel, how are you feeling right now? Using that aata. What is happening is perspective building will come in. And a lot of curricular outcomes are getting done. If a child is holding aata in his hand, fine motor skills are getting enhanced. The other thing is his emotional state is coming out and getting expressed. Perception building is happening. Three-dimensional figure is in his hand. Right?
Right.
And then he can actually understand what is push and pull. You know, forces come into play. So it depends on the teacher. How creative can she get? How much is she connecting with that chapter or the topics that she's teaching? Because automatically when you put yourself in a child's shoes, I would say that really helps. Because if you come down to a child's level of understanding, that is when you can relate to the child and the child can relate to what you're saying. You know, itni baar padhate rehte hain. Small example that I always give to teachers in my teacher training workshops is, you know, we always say sound needs a medium to travel. Kisi bachche ko wo medium samajh nahi aata. Wo sirf rat ke jata hai from class 3 till class 8. That child never understands what a medium is. And therefore, in senior school, he doesn't understand what a vacuum is. Medium hi nahi samajh aaya pehle. Because we assume, when we are teaching children, we assume that the child knows this. Whereas the child does not know it. And that is when the disconnect happens in classrooms. And that is when retention paar nahi ho rahi, samajh nahi aa raha, bachche are not doing well. Because humne assume kar liya ki bachche ko samajh aaya jo humne padhaya board. You know? So we need to change the way we are approaching our teaching methodologies. Because the child, you may know, but the child does not know. We have to step ourselves into the shoes of those children. So I think that's where we need to connect with our teaching. If we understand and if we feel that we are here because of our children, we are here as teachers because of those children, then we connect ho jata hai. And I think then the social emotional learning also doesn't become difficult. Right, ma'am?
Right, exactly.
Right. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, one more question I can see, which is an interesting question. And they are asking that some students used to feel neglected when we are teaching them online, actually. Yes, so what can be done for that? How do we deal with such kind of situations?
I think I've already explained this. If we are going to make it again a classroom kind of teaching using Zoom, there will be children who will feel neglected. वही होता है हमारी classrooms में भी. आधे बच्चे back benches क्यों रहते हैं और सारी ज़िंदगी रहते हैं? Because they feel neglected. They don't connect to that board. Why do you think there is multiple intelligence? Why are we teaching multiple intelligence in our B.Ed. courses? Because a child is not as simple as a chalk and a board, right? He's made up of so many aspects and there are so many different interests of the child. So it depends. I mean, agar hum aaj Zoom pe koshish kar rahe, sare bachche interested hoenge, wo nahi hoenge. Because again, it is passive teaching. Make it active teaching and tell me whether they are interested or not. Right? So we need to shift our focus from passive teaching to active teaching. Make it more dynamic and interesting for children. Tabhi engagement hoi.
Right. There is one more question which is related to hyperactive children. That what is to be done of hyperactive children in the classroom related to their emotional and social development?
Yes, Priyanka ma'am will answer this.
Okay, so I think when you have a hyperactive child in your class, again, I would say that when you have some children with special need, you actually need to understand the psychology or the emotional factors behind the child's, the whole behavior. So you will have to figure out that if the child is hyperactive, then what is it that the child is doing at home? Like, I've come across with hyperactive children, and what happened was at home there was no physical activity which was given to them. So what was happening, it's like energy, and energy was not getting channelized. When you have like a hyperactive kid, then you need to give them a lot of physical activity. You have to give them a lot of mental challenges to put their energy to. So if you have a hyperactive child, maybe you can connect with the parents and ask the parent to put them to some sport or some activity.
It is.
Where they can utilize that energy and then have a good sleep, and then they can come to school, and in school maybe you can give them activities probably, where they are more involved with it physically rather than mentally. Because if they physically exert, then they will mentally give you attention. So here also a coordination between the student, like the teacher and the parent, is important.
Yes, thank you so much for the answer. I hope the participant who asked this question, the queries are solved. And the session is going so informative. People are so excited, very much pleased to hear all the examples. So thank you so much, ma'am. Any other question if we can have in the chat box? I cannot see any other question now. So we can, Benita ma'am, can we move towards the
closure? Any other question anybody has?
Vishali ma'am, I have a certain query.
Yes, please.
That these days, those parents who have their young children, but the point is, at the time of lockdown, we all are working online, whether we are teachers or whether we are office girls or anyhow. We are working online throughout the day, and night also the things are going on in our minds. So how to spend time with children at this time? And you are so much occupied with the things.
You have to give them engaging activities. That is why I've been saying, if you give them engaging activities, they're engaged. Give them things at home. Choti si cheez hai, ask them, okay, now go outside and collect leaves that have fallen outside. Leaf painting karo. Feel the leaves. Collect leaves and flowers that have fallen outside. Chalo, cards banao. When you go back to school, you can take them. you know, we have to actually kind of think that the child needs to be engaged while you are working, and engaged in a manner that the child is enjoying it and is also getting a learning outcome.
Yeah.
And that is
not feeling neglected, actually.
Yes. Yeah. So there is an activity which is happening right there. You are working on the computer and the child is working there. So it's like working. And you can also, you know, a very interesting thing is, maine jaise kaha tha, drawer de do ek. Give them a drawer. Give them cutlery sets, chaanto. Put them back. They will love to do it.
Yeah.
They will love to do these things. And then what is happening is sorting and grading skills are happening.
Yeah.
And when the child is feeling things, automatically there is a lot of sense that is going into the child's mind. And experiential learning ho jaati hai. It's just that we make it so difficult for ourselves. We don't, because we are not connecting with that child. You know, hum adult ki tarah sochte hain. Agar hum ki tarah soche, to it automatically comes out.
That's true. Very good answer, ma'am.
Yes.
It's really nice.
Ma'am, can I ask a question?
Yes, please, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes. Actually, I just want to know how we can work with those children who are very introvert at that time.
Okay. See, again, an introvert child is having a pattern of being an introvert. Introversion is nothing but a fortress a child makes around himself to keep himself emotionally protected, right? Okay. So, you need to figure out that what is it that is bothering the child? Why is the child fearful of speaking up, whatever the child is thinking? Maybe at home, there is something which is stopping the child from sharing. Or maybe the child is being shamed for sharing.
Okay.
So you have to encourage the child to share more with you. And even if the child is not sharing any substantial information, be very encouraging towards the sharing. So here, if you will start giving like a little more attention to this child who is introvert, try to be friends with him. Try and break the fortress that a child has built around him. And then you will be able to figure out that what was the reason behind the child being an introvert.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am, for the nice.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Anshul, yes, ma'am.
Please,
if we can float question to the participants, if they want to ask something, they can unmute themselves and can ask any question.
I have a question.
Yeah, please.
Ma'am, since we are dealing with kids, it's still at least easier. But when you're dealing with adolescents, making them understand coming for, you know, Zoom classes is a slightly difficult. Because when you are having, you know, adolescents especially, they may be present sometimes, but they're not present. So keeping a track of depression in the classes also, it's a big difficulty. I mean, for the sessions. So, you know, sometimes you can't make them understand, you know, this classes is actually for them. But when you're dealing with kids, it's okay. But when you're dealing with, you know, class 9, 10, 11, 12, that time, the problem strikes for the teachers actually to take regular classes. Because in schools, the problem is different. Now, since we are all going digital, the class taking in, especially, you know, in these Zoom or other platform, is all the more very, you know, tedious for teachers who are actually taking for higher classes.
It's just Sanli was speaking.
See, I totally understand the situation right now, because I have a son who's in 12th standard now, and I see them having their Zoom classes. And actually, teachers have to struggle a lot to put them all together and take the full class to them.
Very true.
So the thing is that what you need to do is, whenever you're dealing with an adolescent or a teenager, what you have to do is you have to make the teenager responsible. That's the first step. So you have to tell them that if you do not attend this class or miss this class, then it is going to be your loss. So make them responsible for whatever is happening in the class and tell them that if this is something, if you miss, it is not going to be covered again. And also, I've been seeing, like, you know, you haven't asked this question to me, but I've been hearing a lot of news about you know, how the teenagers have been misusing the Zoom classes. Exactly. Like, you know, they've been posting pictures, writing, you know, the unruly things on the
and plus they're and all using that. Actually WhatsApp a lot, and plus they are using digital media, especially by, you know, going by doing such thing, which I don't want to mention, you know, which everybody was
yes,
there.
Yes, I understand. Yes, I understand. So the thing is, here, what are they trying to do? See, here, the dark side of the masculinity is showing up in their behavior, right? And being a female teacher, sometimes it gets very embarrassing for you to handle such things. Yes. I know what you're talking about. So the best thing is to tell the child, dekho kya hota hai when somebody is bullying you. Now, this teenager is trying to bully you as a female, right? So you as a female need to stand up for yourself in a very firm way. And, you know, the bully is happening because they think that they have a power over you. So once you discharge that power and make it very normal or nominal, then the child will think twice before doing it. You know, it is we, if there is a, you know, a photograph which is objectionable, which has been posted on the screen share, and we say, oh my God, what is this? And who's doing this? And like, what nonsense it is. Instead of saying that, you just say that, okay, fine. You know, just move it. Like, usko hatao, yaar, ye topic se related nahi hai. If you will minimize it, then the child will lose charge over it. If there is a bad conversation happening there, you just say a word, you know, which will just diffuse the whole thing. Because they're basically bullies.
Yeah. Sorry? Instead of giving importance to it and making it more hype up, we can just ignore it.
Yeah, just ignore it. Just ignore it. Achha, ye photo, isko please hatao, yaar. Mereko nahi dekhna hai, tumhari girlfriend ka photo. Simple. You know, the more you will hype it, the more you will talk about it, the more you will give the power to that child over there who's trying to bully you or take over your class.
Okay.
So the best thing is to minimize it.
Yeah. Because, you know, in classroom, kya hota hai ki hum unko bol sakte hai ki phone band kar do, your laptop, matlab unko access nahi hai, but abhi kya hai ki hum dekh nahi sakte.
Yeah, hum bhool gaye na ki yahan ye dikh raha hai isme.
Wo kya kar raha hai abhi?
Itna ki dhyan raha baudi bhoot. नया कर्तव्य पहली बार कर रही हूँ इतनी शानी थारी तरह शानी थोड़ी ना हो सको एक बारी में दिखाऊं कुछ और करूं कुछ और
मैम प्लीज म्यूट योर
इट इज नॉट फ्रॉम माय एंड
मैम कैन आई आस्क वन क्वेश्चन
हूसोएवर इट इज प्लीज
आई वाज एक्चुअली सेइंग आई वाज जस्ट सेइंग since, you know, in classroom, adolescents were not allowed to use phones so much. Now, since everything is digital, they are actually using laptops, they are with phones, and parents are also giving up. So the problem and responsibility now lies upon teacher and the parents also. Because now it's not upon us totally. The parents also have to checklist, you know.
See, Shalini, I would like to add one more thing here. See, why do you think our children using sexuality as a weapon right now? They are actually using it as a weapon because it was it's a social stigma that you don't talk about such things.
Sex, yeah.
So if as a teacher, like, see, we cannot to an extent change the mindset of a parent. Some parents are liberal, some parents talk about it, some parents are okay with it, some parents may not be okay with it. But as a teacher, if we make it a part of our normal conversation, that it is okay to talk that word, you know, sex is okay to be spoken, or it is okay to you know, have this kind of a conversation. Agar hum usko normalize kar denge na, to iska jo charge hai bacche ke upar se, wo bhi khatam ho jayega. You know, wo jo hum baat karte hai, Adam and Eve ki, that forbidden apple. So it is like a forbidden apple. You don't forbid it. Give it to the child. And the child will lose interest in it.
Yes.
So I think that's the best thing to do.
Yeah, I agree with you, Priyanka ma'am, because I have seen that teachers usually find it very difficult in middle school, especially in grade 8, to teach children about the reproductive system in classrooms. Yeah. And when I go to train teachers, this is one chapter that they always ask. It's so embarrassing in the class to teach that, because children come up with very weird questions. It basically, what ma'am is trying to say is also the same thing. It's basically, if we are embarrassed about handling it in classrooms, the child senses it. They are smarter than us.
Yes.
And they sense it, and then they kind of use it as a charge against you. But the moment you kind of diffuse that charge, it it won't be an embarrassing chapter or it won't be an embarrassing topic to deal with.
Yeah.
And teachers have found it very useful. I mean, I've tried it with them. And when I go back to back for the workshops, they've always said that it worked out in class. So what Priyanka ma'am is saying, it's a very, very practical way to deal with it in classrooms.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a very helpful answer for teachers. They can deal with the students in this manner very easily. So, Vinita ma'am, can we now move towards the winding up?
Yeah, why not? Mandu yes. Kar rahe hai, ma'am. Vishali ma'am, Vinita ma'am. It's really very nice. Aur ek achha session humne aaj attend kara. Bahut
yes, ma'am.
It was wonderful.
Yeah,
it was wonderful, really wonderful because all your participants were really great. We really had a nice time.
Really enjoyed ourselves.
Yes. So we are really thankful to you, ma'am, both the speakers of the day and Sneh ma'am and SFI principal Vanda Jaglan, Alam sir SGMC, and all without whom and without Sneh ma'am's permission it was not possible. So thank you, ma'am, for giving us this permission to organize this webinar, and all the lovely participants of the day, those who have taken the active participation and make this day more special, and especially for the speakers, those who were giving their time and sharing their views and thoughts, and people were enjoying, and I'm sure that people have come across so many new facts that we can apply in our lives, especially those mothers who have little children.
Very helpful.
They wow. have got very good points today. That how to deal with them in this time of COVID especially. And also, ma'am, which I came to know today, that while playing with children, concentration is also improved with children, right? Because these days, children are not having concentration. They have concentration to play video games. But they can't concentrate on maths, English, or some other problems. So this is really nice that parents are sitting together and playing games and getting times involved and things are coming up. So really nice, ma'am. And the examples taken by you people are really amazing. Cooking and cleaning and playing. These are simple things which sometimes it doesn't come into mind of a parent that it can also be applied. The reading and writing is not only required, but in this way also things can be improved. So I'm really, really thankful to you, both the speakers, for such a lovely session. We are thankful.
Ma'am, is Preeti Goyal ma'am there? Yeah. Preeti Goyal ma'am is there around?
Yes.
Yes. I would welcome, yeah. So request to Preeti Goyal of Education to please speak a word of thanks.
Thank you, Anshul. Thank you so much. Really, it's a great opportunity that we have the ability of the parents that this should work as a teacher.